Thank you very much. And I'm really pleased to be here, and it's quite an honor to be surrounded by so many entrepreneurs and innovators and, of course, important public servants. So thank you all very much for having me here. The question is interesting, because when you look at when I was, say, 30, you know, first, I never imagined that we'd even have mobile phones. Just to tell you how this was, I mean, mobile phones were still a complete rarity. Matter of fact, the very first time that I came across a mobile phone, my law firm at the time had a mobile, you know, the regular phone, a big, you know, the regular phone, and you carried it around in the car. It was a massive thing, you know, and you carried it. So it was mobile in the sense that you could take it anywhere with you, but it was a massive, it wasn't a little device. And that was even rare then. No, the rare was even software. This was, you know, so it's a complete, what we're seeing today is completely, it's just way beyond what anyone could have imagined. I remember that there was a time, you know, I did a lot of research on computer-generated evidence. I'm a professor of law, as you know. So I was doing a lot of work in the early 90s, about 1990, computer-generated evidence. I was saying then that there will be problems with proving stuff that are computer-generated because of the way our laws were written. You know, so our laws are written with script in mind, writing on a letter, paper, letters, figures, or maps, that kind of thing. So clearly, there was going to be a problem with these new devices. You know, somebody sends a text. So if you libel me, if you send a text around and it's libelous, how do I prove it, given the state of the law and all that? At the time, it was considered completely esoteric. Nobody thought this was made any sense. So I think what has happened in the past few years, especially in the last 15 odd years, is, in my view, and I'm sure there are some people who are much more far-sighted than myself, I think it's just incredible. There's no way anyone can describe it, no way anyone can, you know, cope with even the of that development. So it's really quite incredible.
Thank you very much. Let's clap for His Excellency. I guess as a follow-on to that, right, given the pace of technological change, what things from that era, or what do you think that you could, that were the things that you would have liked to have been able to do? They're not regrets, but they're more like wishes. What are the things you would have wished? I wish this was put in place. I wish these opportunities were more widely available.
Yeah, practically everything, you know, practically everything. Everything I see today, it would have been fantastic if I could do it, if we could do it then. I mean, just from the point of view of somebody involved in research and legal practice, I mean, today, things are so much easier. I mean, there was a time I spent looking for a case, just looking for a particular case, because I was writing on illegitimacy. I was writing a particular article on illegitimacy in Nigeria. I spent 6 weeks in the High Court of Lagos, where they have their files with all their cases. I mean, after the 6 weeks, I had a terrible cold. I was ill for a while because I was just looking for a particular case. I finally found the case after 6 weeks. But now everything is digitalized. I can sit with my laptop. I can research cases from anywhere in the world. I can visit libraries. I can do all those kinds of things. I mean, I certainly would have cut short my entire period I spent between graduating and becoming a professor by at least half. By at least half the time, because a lot of time is spent doing all sorts of stuff. And besides, look at what you guys are getting into now. I mean, payment systems and all of that, with lots of what you guys are doing. I just finished speaking to some guys who are doing work on cryptocurrencies and all that. These are developments that if we had them, I'm sure we would have done better than you guys.
I can somewhat believe that, but we'll see. governance and how you think about the challenges Nigeria faces and what it needs to do to provide a better future for everybody.
Research, teaching, exposes you a great deal to many different views. And one of the things I found with being a teacher is that I'm not bothered about criticism, because I've been criticized, my views have been criticized from the very first day that I walked into a classroom. So not only am I, is my work, and when I say criticize, it's more people saying, I don't agree with this, I don't agree with that, you know, and arguing with you about stuff. So I'm in a faculty where my work is being examined constantly, where it's being critiqued constantly. So I get to a classroom, I'm teaching students, and somebody who hasn't studied anything at all raises his hand on the back and says, but professor, I don't agree with that thing you said. And here's a guy who hasn't even studied anything. I mean, after all the recent
opening government.
So for me, I think that what it's done for me is that it's helped me to be able to just, you know, I'm not worried at all about people saying I don't agree with you, or people saying I don't even like what you're doing, because I've faced much sharper criticism, if you see what I mean. So I think that what my background, my personal background has done, it has helped me more to, first of all, to recognize that you're only one idea and one set of ideas, and there's so many people with more, possibly more brilliant ideas. The idea is to be able to aggregate those ideas for the common good. The idea is to be able to get what everybody is saying, understand what they're saying, understand their perspective, and see how we can, you know, use that for the good of as many people as possible. So that's, you know, basically what my background has done.
So that's an amazing. When you think about Nigeria over the next 30 years, what do you think is the one thing we need to get right, really show our potential, to convert the potential that we keep saying?
For me, I'm very narrow. It's integrity. That's what it is. It's integrity. It's about, you see, the problem we have is, look at the sheer amount of resources that we have, and look at the sheer creativity. Because people who are in politics, go into politics because they want to make money from politics. And that's what's putting it as delicately as possible. Many people who are in politics just want to make money from it, and they want to steal resources. So by and large, it affects everything. It affects judgment. So for example, you want to build, rather than pay teachers, or rather than invest in education, or invest in medical care, or whatever it is, because it means paying actual individuals, it's easier to build, to say I want to go and build a road, right? Because you are more likely to make some money. So it affects judgment, it affects everything. I think that if we were to get people, able to hold people to account, that will be, and I keep saying that if you have an honest person, if the president is an honest man, 50% of the problems are solved. 50%. Because most of our problems center around corruption, center around the use of funds by people stealing funds directly, or people looking for a way of stealing funds. That really is a major problem. If we give all our resources, let's even say 70% of our resources went on the things that we want them to go to, rather than to private pockets, we could never be where we are today. Impossible. We'll be several times ahead of where we are. So I think that, for me, that's the main problem.
And what do you think, before we launch into these questions, that young people need to do to ensure that there is integrity and that we are on that right path?
I think the important thing to bear in mind is that integrity pays. It's the only thing that works. You know, I was speaking to people, some members of our cabinet, and we're talking about the very idea that honesty, you know, it's not, when you say honesty is the best policy, and those kind of cliches, people really think that that you're preaching a moral, that this is a moral preachment or some kind of moral adage. It's not. It really makes sense, because trustworthiness is how business is done everywhere. If you're trusted, if people can trust you with credit, if they can trust you to give you credit, if they can trust you with anything, you will, whatever that thing is, you're going to advance me, you're going to do a lot with it. And I think the important thing is to teach people. I think the important thing is, you know, get people to understand that. That is not a moral issue. It's an economic issue. It's a business issue. That if you can be trusted, if people can trust you, there's no way in the world that you will fail. You know, and I think that many people understand that Nigerians are some of the most creative people in the world. Many people know that we're some of the best minds, but people are worried about the integrity issues when they're dealing with us. Yeah.
That's an amazing response. And I guess for us, I mean, that's something I've also found, especially from business, because I think many people think it's just a government issue, right? But even in business, you know, it's more personal. And it came from, just looking at the name, Mr. Ebuta A.N. And I think the question, which I liked a lot, was, what is the most valuable lesson you have learned in your current role as vice president? And how did you measure it or arrive at that conclusion?
That's a good question. I think the most important lesson that I've learned is how difficult it is to actually get things done in our environment. You know, I think that there is a huge gap between a stated objective and getting it done. And the reason for that is because, not just in the public service, but also in the private sector, we're not big on timelines. We're not very big on efficiency. We're not big on productivity in a very positive sense, you know? So we let things slide. So if, for example, I ask you to do me some work and I'll give you next Wednesday. It's not necessarily delivered next Wednesday. And it's not such a big deal if you don't, you know? So I don't even feel very angry or frustrated if you don't give me next week. So if you give me 2 weeks' time, I still think, well, that's not. So there's something about how we're not very big on time, on maintaining our timelines, on keeping to promises that are made, on saying, I have set this time, I'm going to deliver at that time. I think that's really the difference between us and some other people that have, in terms of productivity, and this for me is one of the biggest lessons. So I have a group of, most people who work with me are quite young, you know, they're very, very young people, you know, and I think that something that they bring to the table in a lot of cases is maybe more efficiency. I think they're a bit more efficient than other people that you tend to work with, and they are, and I think that really the whole idea is to get people to be much more efficient, to be much more time conscious, to be much more faithful to, you know, deadlines and promises and those kinds of things that they make. So for me, that's the biggest thing, implementation. How to make sure that stuff is implemented when you set it.
There's going to be a small change in format, which is
the questions one after the other. Okay, I'll just take a bunch of them.
Okay, let's.
Should we take a bunch first and then?
Of course, you know, I reserve the right to answer or not to answer. Okay, thank you very much. So I have from Anoli is the unemployability, and I agree with you that it's a major challenge. Part of it, of course, as you said, has to do with training, is the kind of training that people get. And I think that we suffer, in some sense, a double jeopardy, because not only is training inadequate, there's also technology that's moving so far ahead. You have robots and all sorts of artificial intelligence that are taking away jobs. So it's even a much more complex thing for us. So you start by people not being able to basically read and write, make presentations, critical reasoning and all of that, to the bigger problem of technology taking away people's jobs. So it is a complicated one. But I think that one of the advantages we have is that technology is going to help a great deal in unraveling a lot of the problems. So for example, we had in our Empower program, the Empower Graduate Employment Program. Basically, the idea of the Empower was to engage graduates who have no jobs, but also to train them, and the training is basically an employability type skill. So everyone has a device, so we put you onto a platform where we have all sorts of stuff that you can learn. I think that today, you know, if you look at the most, who was it? I was talking to someone recently, and they were telling me that the most subscribed to videos are videos teaching people how to do something. And I think that the great investment that we need to make is to push people to those sorts of, to that sort of training. Today, people are going to, so after you graduate, say you have a BSc agriculture or whatever it is, you know, it doesn't necessarily make you the best farmer or even a smart advisor on farming. But then there's so much now, so much material available now that helps you to hone whatever skills you want to hone. So if all you want to do is to talk about improved seedlings and how to market improved seedlings, how to even find where they are, you can learn a lot of that today. So I think really what we need to do and what we're trying to do is to push people to improve themselves, and a lot of self-improvement is what this is going to do. A lot of collaboration is also important. You see, my take is that we are no longer going to be able to teach the way we used to teach. And for me, this is particularly important because I'm a teacher. You know, we're no longer going to be able to do that because it just doesn't make sense. You can't teach people the way we used to teach law. No one's going to teach law like that in 10 years' time. So we started with clinical education, where you set a problem and you say, solve the problem. You go on. You aggregate the principle around it, but we set you a problem. So we tell you that Mr. X walked into a room, saw two people dead, another person comes into the room and says, Mr. X, you killed these people. So you tell us from legal principles. I don't have to teach you those principles. I just show you where they are. You go and apply those principles. So I come in, I'm some kind of an interlocutor, some kind of a moderator, who just shows you how those principles work with the case. There is no time to say criminal law, the definition of criminal law is, the definition of crime is, you know, there's no time for that anymore. So things have moved along, and I think that we have to teach, we have to change the way we teach, which is a lot of the work we did at the last education summit that we held, the government health and education summit. And we've been looking at these issues of critical reasoning, collaboration, pushing people to technology and using technology. So it's a, and I think it's also a big opportunity for private sector to develop new ways of teaching, because the next 10 years, in my view, will present all of those kinds of challenges. Benjamin wanted to know about that people who are in innovation find that the brick wall with government. And true, I think that you're absolutely right about that, because and the reason is that there is no, we just haven't created enough platform for people to interact with government. You know, and that's why the Civic Hub is one of those excellent examples of situations where people who are innovation, especially innovation that is socially relevant, have some kind of link with government. And one of the reasons why I took particular interest in the Civic Hub, and maybe I was one of the very first to come here, to come and visit the hub, is because of what they were talking about. I mean, for those of us in government, we want to see how problems in government can be resolved. So it's more interesting. And so, you know, that interaction is important. But I think that we need to create those platforms. And I think that the various innovation organizations or private sector people also have to take the trouble to break that, or to open up the clock or the obstacles. I think we just need to be much more aggressive about it. So an interaction like this is important, and interactions like this are important. It's important that we create these opportunities for people in government to come and talk, to hear what is being said, to see what is being done, and that gives, you know, also opportunities for a lot of interaction. And I'll give you a few examples of what we've done. You know, for instance, when we did the Aso Villa Demo Day, I'm not so sure how many people are familiar with that. that was a challenge that we threw, an innovation challenge that we actually threw to innovators all over the country. And was very well subscribed all across the country. Very many young people came together with their innovations and ideas. We finally, I think there were over 4,000 different innovations. We worked out of Lagos, Port Harcourt, I believe Kaduna or somewhere. But we finally were able to aggregate about 100 or so young people who had different innovations. And we finally brought down, I think, 30 to come and meet with the president. And Zuckerberg, Mark Zuckerberg was also there at that particular one. We've done another one since. We're also doing the Students Innovation Challenge, which is one that we're collaborating with the Civic Hub. We're actually collaborating with the Civic Hub. This is a challenge, innovation challenge for students across Nigeria. And already, you know, I'm sure those who are following know that it's already online and people are applying and all that. Aside from that, we're going to do technology hubs in six Nigerian universities. We start with Unilag. We've already got the space for it. They've given us space to do this innovation hub. It's going to be a really creative hub in every way, even beginning from the way it's going to be built. Again, all of this is private sector. All of the young people who we're working with are involved in this whole process. There's the Mechathon, there's the Innovation Hub in Yola, which is also government supported, but it's private sector. That Innovation Hub is one where they recently had a Mechathon for those who have creative ideas about solving some of the humanitarian challenges in the Northeast. And that has proved to be an incredibly well-subscribed innovation. So there are many, we're creating many platforms, we're creating many platforms, many opportunities and all of that. But definitely there's a need to do much more. There's a need to do much more. But I think that innovators also have to be aggressive. They have to work, you know, because government is government, belongs to all of us. And we've got to see ways of opening up the opportunities in government. Moyo talked about values and how your values are challenged all the time and how do you cope. And it's a very good question because your values will always be challenged. Even today, my values are challenged in government, as you can imagine. But you see, let me give you an example. I started out, you know, teaching and practice. And in practice, you know, you find that there are people who would ask you, I mean, so you go and get a job from a bank. The company secretary wants you to split your fee. So the company secretary says, give me 60%, I take 40%. Or these days it could even be worse, you know. So people ask you, so people ask you for, you know, kickbacks and all of that. And I give you another example, NEPA, for example, look at NEPA, you know, it'll fix your meter in such a way that you don't pay. Now let me tell you what, you see, I found, and none of us can say that we're not under pressure to evolve to this thing. I found by experience, that it just pays to stick to your value. And in both cases, those two examples I've given you, I was involved in both examples, and I lost out big time, and found that I just could not, first of all, my conscience couldn't take those things. I mean, I just thoroughly hated the idea of having to split my fees with anyone. I just hated the idea. But I didn't do the work, you know, you didn't do the work. I mean, who are you to now say you want, you know, so it was just for me, it was like, I will not allow you to cheat. But at the same time, you know, there you were, you needed the job. And just the example I gave about NEPA as well. So these people come and give you some outrageous bills, and then someone tells you you can slow down your meter. So if you slow it down, you know. But in both cases, as I said, I got my fingers thoroughly burnt, and I made up my mind, you know. Again, I suppose the faith helps, because I became a born-again Christian. So faith helps, and I made up my mind that, hey, I'm just going to play this thing by the book. And I also learned that it gave me the opportunity, because you see the strength that you get from being able to say that I'm not going to do this. I don't know how to describe it, but it's a very, you're in a very, very powerful position. I found that my law firm, as soon as we made up our mind that we're not going to take, we're not going to do any funny deals, we lost practically all of the corporate jobs that we had. Practically all. Nobody was going to touch us. And for almost 3 years, we were not able to get those kinds of jobs, but we're not just going to pay. Just to tell you how pervasive this corruption is, and this is private sector, it has nothing to do with government. But after that, we then began to get other types of jobs. We're getting intellectual property jobs, we're getting arbitration jobs, we're getting all sorts of very good opportunities that gave us far more money, far more resources. And you know the good thing? These same guys will not give us a job. They will say, if you want a firm that you can trust, go here. They'll tell you that, take it away. They'll tell you, that they won't take any. So over time, it's a painful thing, and there's no one can tell you that it's not, because you must take the pain of it. And look at government. Government is the same. Everybody who comes to you, everybody comes to you. They expect you to do a deal. This is the way the country is. So we have to ask ourselves whether you want to do this or you don't want to do this. And you've got to keep, and people that, look at that. You become a minister or you're, I mean, let's even be vice president. You become anything. The people who celebrate these things, people from church, people from your faith communities, people from anywhere who celebrate these things, expect that you're going to be transformed immediately. They don't like it. So someone shows up after I've been appointed by the president and says, all I want from you, sir, is 1 billion naira to start a business. And then I respond by saying, my salary is 1.75 billion naira a month. Right? That's my salary. Now, that is not my expenses, of course. I mean, government pays for everything, pays for my transport, pays for everything. But that's my salary. I used to earn more than that, at least in legal practice. And this fellow says to me, oh God, please now. You know? Almost as if, forget it, that's just rubbish. And that's the way it is. That's the way people see it. People just think you must be putting your hands somewhere. You must be stealing something somewhere. And if you are not stealing, you are seen as some kind of, you're almost crazy, you're a weirdo. But the truth is that no community can survive on the greed and theft of everyone. It is not possible. It should be the exception. It can't be the rule. So we've got to set ourselves apart. I think that individuals have to say, I'm not going to do this. And it's a short-term thing, in my view. Short-term. Once you establish a reputation for not taking bribes or for not giving bribes, people will know. It may be hard at first, but after a while, that reputation is good for you. And if you look at a lot of companies who work in Nigeria, especially the foreign companies, those companies that have to report in their countries and all of that, many of them have made up their minds that they're not going to do any of those things. We also know that they're not going to do any of those things. So what to deal with some of the more shady, dodgy characters from different parts of the world where they don't report stuff and all that. But people make up their minds, but I don't want to do it. And that's it. And if you want good service, you still go to that. So I think, you know, it's a tough thing, but we must form, as it were, a community of like-minded people. And I've always established that wherever I am, people who think like me, and I engage only people who think like me, I only bring on board people who think like me. I don't hire people who I think might be dodgy. I don't hire them. I hire people who I think will reason the way I reason, think the way I reason. So that we have a community of people whose ideas and ideals reinforce each other. Okay, Ibrahim, an introduction. I agree entirely. I don't have any problem with people running for office at any age. As a matter of fact, I've benefited from being very young and being able to achieve stuff when I was extremely young. So, I mean, I'm fully in support of it. I'm fully in support of that. And I very strongly believe that this is the view of government. I don't think there's anyone that I've heard in government who feels that people shouldn't run for any office at whatever age they wanted to run for office. I think that it's more a matter of, you know, let people play the field. But my view is that we should focus on developing ourselves, We really should focus on developing ourselves. Unfortunately, sometimes because of the mediocrity that we see in government, everyone assumes that I can govern. So a guy shows up today and says, yeah, I've been a good, I've done one or two things, I can run the whole country. Sure, I mean, people, and it's because of the mediocrity we've seen in government. That's why anybody assumes that at the age of 22, why can't I be president of Nigeria? Yeah. Because look, surely I wouldn't do this, and it's true. So you say, surely I wouldn't even behave like this. I wouldn't do that. You know. So I think it's important for us to really look at how to develop ourselves, develop strong values, develop our skills, whatever way. You know, I have, as I said, I work with a very large number of young people in my office, very large number. My entire power team, I have a team of people who advise on power. I have a team of people who advise on infrastructure. I have a team of people who advise on the economy. Most of them are under 35, certainly under 40, most of them. You know? So, but you see what I see, because I also worked in government. I started working in government at the age of 31. I was advisor to the then Federal Attorney General. So I worked with him for a period of, you know, a leave of absence from the university for about 4 years. So I worked in government, if it's what I mean. So in some senses, I was trained. I became Attorney General of Lagos there sometime after, about almost 10 years after that. But I was trained, if you see what I mean. I was trained to be an Attorney General. And very few people have that kind of training, because I had worked with one, had seen all that there was to do, had advised and all of that. So it gave me a platform on which I could really do substantial stuff. Not just, I wasn't learning, as it were, on the job. So I think that the experience that young people have working in government is a very important experience. Working in political parties, you know, planning elections, planning campaigns and those kinds of things, you know, owning themselves in manifestos, looking at the practical challenges and problems. I think that that's a very important thing to do. Because really, if you're going to benefit this country as a leader, you definitely need substantial knowledge, substantial exposure, and all of that. It's not just about age, you know, but, you know, it's not just about age. So I think that's what I do. Yeah. Fantastic kind of a commitment to, you know, social causes, a commitment to governance in some way or the other. Because not everyone, because if you're going to work in government, by and large, you're not particularly well paid. You see what I mean? I mean, it's not, certainly, it's not like working in some of the, you know, places where some of you might work and earn, you know, some very serious cash.
You'd be surprised how much of it is equity.
Well, you must be able to afford equity too, I mean, somehow or the other, you know. But the point is that it in some senses is a sacrifice, and there's a certain bit of this also almost like a call. I mean, there's some people, I mean, it's like social entrepreneurs, people who are doing those kinds of things. They are almost invariably people who want to do this sort of thing, who are motivated by this sort of thing, who like to do this sort of thing. And I think government is like that too. You know, I have a few people who are working with me who are, you know, extremely well-trained, you know, have very good degrees on all the best universities anywhere in the world. And they have opportunities elsewhere, but they want to do this. So I think the first thing is to want to do it. Because if you want to do it, that's helpful. You can then, you know, start at least looking for the opportunities. The other thing is that we can do a lot more from the universities, and this is why these interactions are important. We can do a lot more from universities, do internships, you know, have young people from universities who are interested in governance come and do internships in government, come and work with us for a few weeks and all that, and learn the ropes. For instance, the person who works with me today, my special assistant administration, was an intern who came to me when I was Attorney General. She was in the second year then in university, and interned with me every year up until law school and all of that. And that's my senior special assistant administration. You know, so the internship process is important. It helps people, just like in industry. You know, I think we can do a lot more internships in government as well, and that will create opportunities for people to work in government. Yeah.
Next four.
I think the first was Ololade wanted to know the challenges in transiting from one profession to the other and all of that. I think I'm not entirely certain that I experienced a transition. And it might be strange to say so, but that's the honest truth. So I was a teacher, and I was in practice as well. And because my first exposure to public service was in the area of law, because I was an advisor to an attorney general, and then became an attorney general. And thereafter, you know, went back into practice and politics. And you see, with politics and social causes, I've always been involved from when I was from secondary school even. I've been involved in one cause or the other, or several, you know. So human rights activism, anti-corruption, child abuse. I'm a cause person. So I think in so many ways, the special group type politics, I've also been involved in, not partisan politics, but pressure group type, you know, being involved with this group or the other who are advocating something, you know, or the other. So in some senses, I am not certain that there has been a transition. Maybe just for me, just been, you know, a continuum as opposed to a transition. One of the things I found, for instance, I also, as you know, I'm pastor church for very many years, up until 2014, even 2015, I was still pastor. One thing I found is that all of what you learn as you go along are useful in whatever you then become. I found, for example, that campaigning, you know, for when we were campaigning in 2015, I was able to go to markets, to go into the bus, talk to people, because I've done that as a pastor. I give out my tracts everywhere. People abuse me. When I give a tract, get out. If you want us to come to your church, go away. We don't want to come to your church. We don't believe what you are saying. You pastors are crooks. I've heard all that. Person to person. So I think all of that, you know, works, you know, and I think that one must just embrace the opportunity, whatever those opportunities are, so that you are just a better voice. You are just a better voice at the end of the day. So I'm not so sure that a transition, I think, is just, if you like, a whole complement of experiences that have, you know, shaped what I have become and what I am becoming. I think that there is still a long way to go.
Okay, so that's another thing. And Sarah wanted to know, Sarah, your concerns about healthcare and about how, you know, commitment of government healthcare. Absolutely, and I agree with you that we haven't met the targets at all. You know, there's a 1% in the Health Act and all that. So unfortunately, one of the problems we've had with this 1% thing is that practically every sector has this 1%, 2% pool. In fact, the other day we were totaling the 1%, 2%, you know, it went over 100%. And that's without providing for anything else. So it's probably not the wisest approach to it, because everyone struggles for their, you know, and that's what happens. People write legislation and just put a percentage. Now, it's important for us to invest in healthcare and education. Absolutely. And no one denies that. But we can't invest, you know, in my view, from budget alone. What has happened in the past is that we've always insisted that we want budget for healthcare. What we're pushing is national health insurance. There has to be a different way of funding healthcare. Today, everybody is out of pocket. People are paying out of pocket for everything. Whereas we should have a national health insurance scheme. We have one, but it's not been made compulsory, and everyone has to contribute to it. But that's the only way to fund healthcare of a country of almost 200 million people. There's no way you can budget for it. The other thing is that people tend to look at national budget, that's the federal budget, as the budget funding healthcare. By the way, as you know, the states are primarily responsible for healthcare, not the federal government. As with education, the states are primarily responsible. So primary schools and secondary schools are run by states. Federal government has only 100 schools.
you know. But people tend to focus on what federal government is spending, whereas we ought to focus on what the states are spending. Because it's the states that are responsible for these things constitutionally. So there's no way the federal government can provide funding for the states for education, no way. So the so federal government supports the states. So far, we supported the states under this administration to the tune of 1.91 trillion naira. That's support for states. The problem is that the states also need to generate their own income. There needs to be IGR. Most states are not generating. They just don't have, they're not generating enough. So focusing on healthcare and all of that is a function of how much you earn, how much you have, and all that, and then trying to devote some resources to it. And I think that we're getting a lot of that, you know. For instance, when we're looking at malnutrition, and this is one of the issues that came up when our discussions with Bill Gates and Co. We're looking at malnutrition. So children between the ages of 0 and 5 need to be fed. We have a school feeding program where we're feeding about 7 million children today. It's not a healthcare, is what I mean. But it's an important bridge to what we're talking about. So we know that this feeding addresses the question of malnutrition. You know, and we intend to continue to do it because it's an important part of the whole healthcare process and all that. So there are different programs also that may not be factored into spending, the healthcare spending, but it's also part of healthcare spending. But overall, I agree with you entirely. There's far, we have a long, long way to go in terms of, but I think we just have to be much smarter about it. Now we have to look at national health insurance as a major way of funding. I wanted to know what tech giants, how government is supporting the tech community. I can't tell you that there is a deliberate focus on government supporting directly. I mean, I've talked about the various challenges and all of those things that we're putting out there to encourage it. But I know there's an innovation fund that BOI has. And the CBN has also been talking about creating a fund for innovation, for technology and innovation. In the same way as we have a fund for agriculture, in the same way as we have one for hospitality, hotels, etc. And I think that that's an important thing, if we're able to get that done, especially the CBN's fund, they have much more money. But aside from those expected plans, there is no real focus, if you see what I mean, on trying to fund technology startups or, you know, technology generally. But frankly, I believe that technology by itself, you know, I think it's such an incredible growth area. And people are always, there's so much money that's going to come there. Of course, it'd be helpful if government could support by, you know, low interest loans and all of that. But I think the innovation by itself, you know, has such a wide range of opportunity, and people are making tons of money from what I see. You know, Flutterwave and all, Angela, all the people, all these payment systems, Banga, and all the people, they're doing all sorts of things, you know. In fact, I think we should really be thinking very seriously about, you know, looking at taxes more.
So, we're taxed. Pay our tax.
Yeah, the sure.
Okay, for me, mentors, no role models, what can we do?
Yeah, I mean, the truth is that even getting a set of values around which we all agree is an important thing. And I think that I've talked in the past about building a new tribe. You know, a new tribe, if you like, of Nigerians who agree on certain critical things. And I think that a lot of it has to do with what, you know, I mean, look at the basic about integrity, very basic thing, trustworthiness. These are very, very basic things. Not respecting respecting ethnicities, not necessarily respecting ethnicities. So, for example, we shouldn't bother ourselves about where people are from, whether they're Igbo, Yoruba, or Hausa, or whatever it is. We should look at
questions around residence. So where do you live as opposed to where are you an indigene of or whatever it is? We should de-emphasize those things because those things only exacerbate the problems that we have as a people and don't help us in any way. In any event, I know for a fact that it doesn't matter where people are from. You have excellent people from everywhere. Even some of the worst people you know are probably people from your own ethnic groups. You know. So it's an irrelevant consideration in terms of building societies and building communities. So I think it's come to agree on certain values, agreeing on those values and trying to live up to those values. You see, the question of role models, I think all over the world, people are finding it very difficult to find role models. That's really the truth, you know. So maybe what we need is some kind of blockchain technology, you know, where we're all just gonna come back together, you know, like not, we're not looking up like that, we're looking more laterally. Maybe that's what we need, maybe that, because really, this is something that I agonize about all the time, you know, that we need to be able to come as a community, as a group of people, as opposed to necessarily looking for people who represent. But people disappoint all the time anyway. So I think even if we agree on values, and we start building a community of people who agree on those values. Thank you very much.
So what do you think, you know, there's a group of very influential young people in this room. They're all going to go out and do amazing things. As we think about the Nigeria that we need to have over the next 30 years, what are the things we need to keep in mind now and going into the future? Where should we be building knowledge and investing? Where should we be dedicating our hours of service to ensure that this country can be just like the progress you've seen over the last 30 years? We can also come back and tell the same stories about how Nigeria was part of the progress that the world sees over the next 30 years.
Personally, I think a lot should be spent. A lot of time, spare time should be spent on education. That is educating young people wherever they are. And I think technology offers that opportunity in very many unique ways. So for me, I think the greatest contribution that we can make, or that young people can make, is in trying to create platforms to educate other people. When you look at what's going on all over the country and many parts of the country, there is a problem with education. There's a problem with education. Lots of people out of school, you know, we need to get to them. We need to reach these people somehow or the other. I think government has an important role to play, federal government, state government, local government, but also, you know, private people, especially people who have access to technology, who can use the technology to educate, to bring people on board. And I think also the whole concept, that whole concept of social entrepreneurship, where entrepreneurship is not just about profit, where there is something that you're contributing to society. So you're not just building a business that's just looking in one direction. You're building a business that also is helping your community, helping people. And we can look at that, we can say, not only, so this is our profit. So our profit this year was 100 million, but our profit also was 100,000 young people that we trained and all of that kind of thing. Not just, you know. So I think it's, you know, and it's not just a CSR thing is what I mean. So it's built into the fabric of the business. Yeah,
we call that mission-driven entrepreneurship.
Fantastic.
So we talk about
ambition.
Yeah. So it's not just about, it's not social entrepreneurship. Yeah. It's about building a business that has a purpose that enriches the life of a community. Because as I like to say, you have to have a society to make money.
Absolutely.
If you don't have a society, you're Afghanistan. I don't think the billionaires in Afghanistan, you're seeing them on the cover of Forbes. And if they are, they probably can't show their face. But it's about building those two together. So this has been a real honor. Thank you so much, sir, for taking the time. Your Excellency, this has been an amazing honor. We'll have Mrs. Adeze just come up.
It's done by Osa Okunfolo. Osa Okunfolo is a graphic artist. He's not here. He's one of our community members. He's he works from Lagos. You know, he works remotely. He's a very busy guy. He started the graffiti movement in Nigeria. You know, and he's been featured on various programs on different platforms like CNN, on BBC. You know, he's been doing us really proud. And he was also commissioned by the Lagos State Government during the Lagos at 50 event. So I don't know if anybody, most of us here must be familiar with Lagos. If you if you're familiar with the law school bus stop, there's this graffiti art. He was, you know, the one that did it, of course. So that's just to show how amazing you are, sir. We really do appreciate you. Thank you. Yes.
Have everyone seated, and we'll have the